The candidate elimination learning algorithm. The candidate elimination algorithm computes the version space containing all the hypotheses from capital H that are consistent with an observed sequence of training example. In case of find-S algorithm, we have seen that we will get only one most specific hypothesis. But in case of candidate elimination algorithm, we will get a version space which contains all the hypotheses which are consistent with the training examples provided. The candidate elimination algorithm is like this. There are two terms. One is maximally general hypothesis represented by capital G, and second one is maximally specific hypothesis represented by capital S. Capital H will indicate the hypothesis space and small d will indicate the training examples. So algorithm will look like this. Initialize the capital G to the set of maximally general hypothesis in capital H and initialize capital S to the set of maximally specific hypothesis in capital H. For each training example, you do the following. There are two possibilities here. One, d may be positive example or D may be a negative example. If D is a positive example, then do the following steps. Remove from most general hypothesis set any hypothesis that are inconsistent with the training example D. For each specific hypothesis in capital S, if it is not consistent with the training example D, then remove that specific hypothesis from the hypothesis set S, add to capital S all the minimal generalizations H of S such that H is consistent with D, that is, hypothesis is consistent with the training example D, and some member of general hypothesis is more general than the hypothesis H. Remove from specific hypothesis set any hypothesis that is more general than another hypothesis in capital S. If suppose the given training example is negative, then remove from capital S any hypothesis which are inconsistent with the training example D, and for each hypothesis G in more general set capital G that is not consistent with the given training sample D, remove that general hypothesis from G and add to capital G all minimum specializations H of G such that H is consistent with the given training example and some member of capital S, that is specific hypothesis set, is more specific than the hypothesis. Remove from G, that is most general set of hypothesis, any hypothesis that is less general than the another hypothesis in capital G. We will consider the same example as we have considered in find-S algorithm, that is enjoy sport training data. There are two terms here. One is S0 and G0. S0 will indicate the most specific boundary that are initialized with all null values. The most specific boundary will grows and will take positive samples only, whereas G0 will indicate the most generic boundary. This will take only negative training samples and it will shrink. S0 is initialized with specific hypothesis, that is all null values, and G0 is initialized with general values, that is all question marks. Let us consider the first training example, that is the first row in enjoy sport training example, that is sunny, warm, normal, strong, warm, same. The target concept is S, hence it will be compared with S0. The values remains same, that is sunny, warm, normal, strong, warm, same, because the first training example is compared with the null values and we will get the same value. Whereas in case of G1, since the first training example is positive, that won't be considered in case of G1. Hence, G1 will take all the question marks as the hypothesis. For next training sample, if we see the target concept, it is yes, means it is a positive training sample. Again, we will compare S1 with X2 to get S2. Hence, as we have got in case of FindS algorithm, the values are sunny, warm, question mark, strong, warm and same. Since X2 is positive training sample, it won't have any effect on general boundary. Hence, G2 will remain again all the question marks. For the third training sample for which the target concept is negative, the S3 value will remain same as that of S2, since the most specific boundary won't consider negative samples. But in case of G3, we need to take one attribute value at a time and replace that one with the question mark. So first question mark will be compared with all the six attributes and that will be taken as one hypothesis. So first hypothesis in G3 will be question mark will be compared with rainy to show the third training sample as negatively classified. We need to have opposite value for rainy. Fortunately, in training example X1 and X2, the opposite value is present, that is sunny. So sunny will be added in the first place and all other question marks are kept as it is. Next, second question mark is compared with X3. So first question mark as it is, second question mark is compared with cold. To show the third training example as negatively classified, we need opposite value of cold. Fortunately, in X1 and X2, we have got warm. So warm is taken and second hypothesis is written. In the third case, if you see, the third question mark is compared with the high. But for high, the opposite value is normal. That is present only in X1. It is not present in X2. If we consider normal, that will show the second training example, that is X2, as negatively classified. Hence, that hypothesis is neglected. Next, if we go for the fourth one, then we have got question mark is compared with strong. To show the third training example as negatively classified, we don't have any opposite value in X1 or X2. If we go to the next value, that is fifth one, we need to compare question mark with warm. Again, the opposite value for warm is not present in X1 and X2. In case of sixth attribute value, that is question mark is compared with change and we have got luckily the opposite value is present in X1 and X2. That will show the first training example as positive, second training example as positive only, but it will negatively classify the third training example. Hence, only that hypothesis is considered. So, G3 will be consisting of three hypotheses as shown over here. For the fourth sample, again, if we check the target concept, it is positive. Hence, we will get S4 as sunny, warm, question mark, strong, question mark, and question mark. Now, if this fourth training sample is compared with G4, we can see that the third hypothesis is not consistent because in the third hypothesis, we got all question mark and same at the end. This same, if at all, we compared with the change, that is sixth attribute value in fourth row, then that will show the fourth training example as negatively classified. But actually in the training sample, it is positively classified. Hence, that hypothesis need to be eliminated. G4 will consist of only two hypotheses. The first one is sunny and all the question marks. Second one is question mark, warm and all the question marks. If we see the final hypothesis, then that will be S4 and G4. To have
all the hypothesis set between these two, there are almost 2 raised to 6 combination that can be derived. There is a set of hypothesis between S4 and G4 which correctly classify the training data. We need to find out the intermediate hypothesis between these two hypotheses, that is S4 and G4. There are 2 raised to 6 combinations that can be derived. Out of them, only 3 are shown here. Those are Sunny, ? Strong, ? And second hypothesis is Sunny, warm, all ? Third hypothesis is ? warm, ? Strong, ? This set of hypothesis will correctly classify the given training sample. Inductive bias. Every machine learning algorithm with any ability to generalize beyond the training data that it sees has some type of inductive bias. This means that if we want the machine to learn the algorithm and we want that this is the assumption made by the model to learn the target function and to generalize beyond the training data. Consider an example, white swan. Suppose that you see a swan for the first time and it is white. It does not follow logically that the next swan you see must be white. It may be black also. But white seems like a better guess than any other color. A machine learning algorithm of the more rigid sort, if it sees a single white swan, then may thereafter predict that any swan seen will be white because you have not shown black swan to it at all. But this, of course, does not follow logically, though artificial intelligence of this sort are often misnamed logical. For a purely logical reasoner to label the next swan white as a deductive conclusion, it would need an additional assumption that all swan are the same color. Tom Mitchell's definition for inductive bias is like this. The assumptions that must be added to the observed data to transform the algorithm's output into logical deduction is called inductive bias. Inductive bias. The fundamental questions for inductive inferences are, what if the target concept is not contained in the hypothesis space at all? Can we avoid this difficulty by using a hypothesis space that includes every possible hypothesis? How does the size of this hypothesis space influence the ability of the algorithm to generalize to unobserved instances? How does the size of the hypothesis space influence the number of training examples that must be observed? Effect of incomplete hypothesis space. Consider the following example which represent the target function. Suppose that there are only 2 samples are given and both are having the target concept as yes, means sky is having the value sunny or cloudy only. Suppose that we have not considered the third example. If we apply the candidate elimination algorithm as before, we will end up with the empty version space. After the first 2 training samples, yes becomes ? Warm, normal, strong, cool, and change. And if this is compared with the third training example now, then ? Is compared with rainy, means any value is acceptable. Then warm is there, normal is there, strong is there, cool is there, change is there. This will show the third training example into positive concept. New hypothesis is overlaying the general one and it covers the third negative training example. So our hypothesis space does not include the appropriate target concept. Unbiased learner. Incomplete hypothesis space. When we call it as incomplete hypothesis space, if the target concept is not present in the hypothesis space, then consider generalizing the representation of hypothesis space to contain the target concept. The size of the instance space, that is capital X, of days described by the 6 available attributes is 96. 96 we have already discussed. We will multiply every possible attribute value in training sample with each other, then we will get 96. The number of distinct subsets available will be 2 raised to capital X, that is 2 raised to 96 possible hypotheses in full hypothesis space. We can do this by using full propositional calculus and or not calculations. Hence, hypothesis space defined by only conjunction of attributes will be biased one, that is it will contain only 973 individual hypotheses. Let us reformulate the enjoy sport learning task in an unbiased way by defining a new hypothesis space H dash that will represent every subset of instances. That is, let H dash corresponds to the power set of capital X, means it contains all the concepts which may be possible in case of capital X. One way to define such an H dash is to allow the arbitrary disjunctions, conjunctions and negations of our earlier hypothesis. For instance, the target concept sky is equal to sunny or sky is equal to cloudy, then we need to have these two samples and we need to make a conjunction of these two sets, that is sunny with all question marks and cloudy with all the question marks. Then only we can able to find that sky is sunny or sky may be cloudy. The definition: consider a concept learning algorithm capital L for the set of instances capital X. Let target concept C be arbitrary concept defined over capital X. Let D, capital D, consisting of training samples and target concept. For every training example, there is a training concept, be arbitrary set of training examples of C. Let learning algorithm for the corresponding training example denote the classification assigned to the instances Xi by capital L after training the data, that is DC. The inductive bias of L is any minimal set of assertions capital B, such that for any target concept C and corresponding training examples that can be shown with the help of an equation read as, for all Xi belonging to capital X, capital B and DC and Xi are derivable from learning algorithm which contains instances and training example. Here capital B will show the set of declarations and DC will show training examples. Xi will indicate the training instances. The inductive system and equivalent deductive systems can be shown with the help of a diagram. In the inductive system, if you see, the training examples and new instances are given as the inputs and we will get the output as classification of new instance or don't know value, means system will fail to identify, that is don't know. Example may be candidate elimination algorithm using the hypothesis space capital H. The same inductive system, if you want to make it as an equivalent deductive system, you need to add inductive bias made explicitly for that. Means you need to consider all the hypotheses which will consisting of the training concept needed. So in case of equivalent deductive system, the inputs are training examples, new instances, and assertions capital H which is containing the target concept. Then you will get the output as classification of the new instance, or the machine may say that it does not know what is the training sample provided. It will fail to identify it. Example is theorem power up. So this equivalent deductive system is theorem prover. Modeling inductive system by equivalent deductive systems. The input behavior of the candidate elimination algorithm using the hypothesis space capital H is identical to that of the deductive systems utilizing the assertion H dash that contains the target concept. This assertion is therefore called as the inductive bias of the candidate elimination algorithm. It will characterize the inductive system by their inductive bias that allows modeling them by their equivalent deductive systems. This provides a way to compare inductive systems according to their policies for generalizing beyond the observed training data. What is inductive learning and what is deductive learning? Deductive reasoning allows you to make statements that are entailed by facts that you know. Example, I'll give you these facts. I watch a movie every Saturday and today is Saturday. You can conclude from these two statements that today I will watch a movie. Deductive reasoning allows you to establish the true statement that I am going to watch a movie today. So it will allow you to establish the true statement. True statement is not there. But in case of inductive reasoning, on the other hand, it will allow you to make statements based on the evidence you have collected so far. Evidence will be present over there. Evidence is not the same as fact. Strong evidence for something only suggests, albeit strongly. That is, it is a fact. All statistical learning is about inductive reasoning. You look at some data, scientifically guess at a general hypothesis and make statements, predictions on test data based on this hypothesis. Inductive learning and deductive learning can be understood with this example. Suppose that you are a kid and I am your father. It is my job to make you to understand that playing fire or heat can cause you burn. So I will make you to understand in such a way that I will show some training examples of burnt people or fire accidents or something with a label dangerous. So you will learn with that examples and will not try to play with the fire. This method of learning is the inductive learning. That is, you are learning with the help of example. You are not getting any experience. On the other hand, the other method is much easier for me to make you learn about the burns, but may be difficult for you. The method is, I will let you play with the fire and just wait to see what will happen. If you get burned, you will learn, don't play with the fire. And when you see fire, you remember it with your incident and will avoid that. This method is deductive learning. In general, deductive learning is conclusion and you will get observation from this. Inductive learning is observation. You will get conclusion from this. All learning algorithms today are inductive, that is, recognizing patterns in big data. Deductive or rule-based learning results in expert systems. We have seen that one in 1980s, and since then it has been abandoned because of the difficulties in creating and updating the expert knowledge. So what we have today is inductive learning, that is, recognizing patterns in big data.